Here is a question. How in the world did a peasant-born small-town scoundrel like Liu Bang became an emperor and founded the Han Dynasty? Well, he's got charms, he's got luck, but most importantly, he's got Han Xing, the greatest general of the era, working for him. Han Xing himself had an underprivileged background and lived in destitute for much of his youth. Yet, he rose to become a legendary general who had never lost a single battle in his career. How did he do it? Well, keep watching as I tell you the story of Han Xing and how he lived his life according to the lessons of the art of war. Han Xing was devastatingly poor. When his mother died in his childhood, he didn't even have money for her funeral. And he had to rely on others for his meal. One time, after mooching off a friend for months, the friend's wife got so upset with him, she started hiding their food. Han Xing couldn't get a job as an official, and he had terrible business sense. Nevertheless, he still got his pride, and he dreamed of making it big one day. But unfortunately, as we know, pride is not something he could literally swallow. So he starved. During this time, he experienced two very important events that defined his life. The first one happened when he was trying to fish for his meal. An old woman saw the starving Han Xing and gave him some food. In his gratitude, he promised that he would repay her manifold for her kindness. But she just laughed him off. She gave him food not because she was expecting any reward, but she was feeling sorry for him. But still, the thought of one day repaying her never left his mind. The other event, which changed everything, was an encounter with a town bully who just wouldn't stop harassing him. He gave Han Xing two options: either crawl between his legs or just kill him right there, if he dared. Despite being poor, Han Xing was actually a big and tall young man who always goes around with a sword. If he wanted to kill this twerp, he could easily do it. But he can't. If he killed the bully, under the draconian law of the Qin Dynasty, he would be sentenced to death. Or worse, he could be sent to the Great Wall or the Qin Mausoleum as slave labor and be worked to death. So Han Xing had no choice but to do what he was asked. This happened to be one of the worst forms of humiliation in Chinese culture. And the fact that news of this incident had spread and everyone thought that Han Xing was a coward burned this event into his memory. But it also taught him the most important lesson in his life, which also happened to be the fundamental of Sun Tzu's art of war. If you know your enemies and know yourself, you will not be imperiled in 100 battles. Han Xing was bigger and he was armed with a sword. Yet he lost the encounter without a fight because his opponent knew his limitations and capitalized on it. Han Xing would then go on to apply this lesson to the battlefield. But first, he needed to become a general. So, in 209 before Common Era, when the rebellion against Qin Dynasty broke out, he joined the rebel army under Xiang Liang. And when Xiang Liang died, he was placed under Xiang Yu, the nephew. He would often suggest strategies and tactics to his superiors. But nah, nobody's going to listen to this annoying nobody. And he was completely ignored. So in 206 BCE, when the Qin Dynasty was defeated and Xiang Yu divided the empire into 18 kingdoms, he defected to Liu Bang, whose background was also a commoner. One time, while serving Liu Bang, he broke some military law, and he was almost executed. But he made an impression on one of Liu Bang's trusted generals and was spared from execution. Liu Bang, however, didn't think much of him and gave him a minor position. Sometime later, Liu Bang's soldiers started to desert him due to the rough living condition in the land of Han. Han Xing also deserted because he felt ignored. But Xiao He, Liu Bang's prime minister and most trusted confidant, recognized Han Xing's talent and chased after him for days to persuade him to return. When they did, Xiao He gave Han Xing a glowing recommendation, and he was made the commander-in-chief of Liu Bang's army. At that time, Han Xing was just 25 years old. After his appointment, Liu Bang asked him how he could strike back at Xiang Yu for cheating him out of Guanzhong, the land that was promised to him by King Huai. So Han Xing replied with a question. Do you think you can match Xiang Yu in terms of strength, bravery, ferocity, and benevolence? After thinking for a while, Liu Bang replied, No, I thought so, Han Xing said. Liu Bang was miserably outclassed in every dimension. However, Xiang Yu still had his limitations. Having worked for Xiang Yu, Han Xing knew that his former lord was a virtual god in the battlefield. He was courteous, he weeps for his sick soldiers, and shared meals with them. So they loved him back. Yet, he hated sharing power. He is also jealous of his general's achievement and was excessively brutal to his enemies. He might be powerful now, but he can be isolated. If Liu Bang sought allies and offered better rewards than Xiang Yu, then he can win. Han Xing wasn't just all talk either. The opportunity for him to prove himself came very soon. On the year 206 BCE, a revolt occurred in Qi, and the state of Zhao was created. While Xiang Yu was distracted by the events near his domain, Han Xing took the opportunity to prove himself. First, he needed to take out the three neighboring kingdoms ruled by the former Qin generals loyal to Xiang Yu. So he sent some soldiers to fix the gallery road that would connect Han to the kingdoms. But as Sun Tzu had said, all warfare is based on deception. The repair was really just a distraction. And while they were fixated on it, Han Xing struck from behind and easily defeated the three Qins. In 205 BCE, after Liu Bang's disastrous defeat against Xiang Yu at the Battle of Pengcheng, Han Xing was tasked with conquering the northern kingdoms. During this campaign, he scored his most famous victory in the Battle of Jingxing, when his army of 30,000 defeated Zhao's 200,000. On the day before the battle, he ordered 2,000 soldiers with extra sets of flags to hide near the Zhao camp, while he also fortified the defenses of a position by the riverbank. On the day of the battle, Han Xing engaged the Zhao army with a skirmish and pretended to retreat to draw them to their defensive position. Usually, it is a bad tactical move to block off your own escape route with something like a river, but he turned it into his edge, because with no way of escaping, his army would fight to the death, and the fortification minimized casualty. Failing to crush them, the Zhao army decided to withdraw temporarily. But as they were returning to their base, they didn't realize it was already taken by Han Xing's covert team. And they raised all their extra flags to give the impression that it was occupied by a much larger force. This ruse caused panic among the Zhao soldiers, and Han Xing took the opportunity to strike back, taking out the commander and routed their army. The rest of the northern campaign went smoothly for Han Xing, and before long, he occupied Qi. By then, he was already an accomplished general with plenty of achievements under his belt. So, he started to get greedy and made demands to be made the king of Qi. Liu Bang, who was desperate for his reinforcement, had no choice but to grant him the title. In fact, Han Xing had become so powerful, even Xiang Yu acknowledged him and offered him northern China if he joined his war against Liu Bang. Han Xing rejected the offer, but it didn't mean that he wasn't interested. Liu Bang had to offer Han Xing more land and expand his domain to finally secure his reinforcement for his final battle against the mighty Xiang Yu. Xiang Yu might be the greatest warrior in the history of China. He had defeated army 20 times larger than his own, while Han Xing's record was just 7 times. Han Xing knew that he couldn't beat Xiang Yu 1-1. But winning wars is not the same as winning fights. Logistics, morale, and many other factors play their parts. So he personally brought 300,000 soldiers to make up for a combined total of 500,000 against Xiang Yu's 100,000. The battle started with some initial successes for Xiang Yu, but the combination of the overwhelming numbers and Han Xing's tactical genius proved to be too much. Xiang Yu was driven back, and Han Xing became the only person who had ever defeated Xiang Yu. Eventually, Xiang Yu's army was finished off through Zhang Liang's psychological warfare, and the war ended as soon as the rest of Chu was pacified. As for Han Xing, he completed his career without suffering a single loss, and he was honored as one of the three heroes of the early Han Dynasty. Later on, Han Xing was made the King of Chu, which included his homeland. So he took the opportunity to take a side trip home to repay the kindness of the old woman who fed him with 1,000 caddies of gold. As for the bully who made him crawl between his legs, Han Xing summoned him to appear before him and thanked him for teaching him the most valuable lesson in his life and hired him to be the captain of his army. It looked like Han Xing was going to get his happy ending, but unfortunately, he ignored the number one rule of the 48 laws of power: never outshine the master. Well, you can't really blame him since that book was written over 2,000 years later. Han Xing's military prowess had become a lingering threat to Liu Bang. Additionally, he made a lot of bad moves to get himself on the wrong side of his boss. He harbored his fugitive friend, who was Xiang Yu's former subordinate, causing him to be demoted from king to marquis. He used every excuse to not attend court, and he regularly offended the emperor. Eventually, Han Xing became a suspect for a rebellion plot. So, the empress and Xiao He, the very person responsible for his rise, conspired to lure him to the palace and killed him. His family was also terminated. At the time, the year was 196 BCE, and Han Xing was just 35 years old. And that was the story of Han Xing, the bullied kid who became the undefeatable general. What do you think? Can bullying ever be beneficial? Or is this just an edge case? By the way, if you'd like to know more about Liu Bang's rise to power and the backdrop of the story, check out the Han Dynasty Origin playlist. As usual, you can do us a favor by liking, commenting, and sharing the video to spread some of that history love. Until next time, stay cool, my bros!